Hello everybody, welcome you all to VTV Sikshana program organized by VTV Belgavi. I am Sanket Deshganti, currently teaching in Mysore School of Architecture. I am handling subject climatology for third semester with subject code 18 ERC 3.3. Okay. So this is the first lecture on climatology. We'll start with the introduction with the outline of whatever we are going to study in this program. So climatology for this semester is basically divided into five modules. So module one is talking about introduction, about the definitions and elements and different factors that are affecting climate. And it also talks about the climatic zones of the world, climatic zones of India. And it also talks about introduction to the thermal comfort, that is comfort in terms of temperature. And following to the module 2, 3 and 4, that will be handled by Professor Kuldeep and Professor Suresh Muthi. So module 2, you'll be mainly learning about the thermal comfort in detail, and also the sun path, the geometry of sun, solar geometry, and also the performance of building based on this sun path. And module 3, you'll be mainly learning about the material properties of U value and construction techniques. And what are the ways to achieve maybe heat gain or passive cooling or passive heating strategies. And similarly in module 4 also you'll be learning about the shading devices, how to harvest sunlight or cut off the sunlight, and also natural ventilation, different modes of ventilation and different systems of ventilation in the buildings. Again, I'll be handling module 5, which mainly talks about the daylighting, how to utilize the daylighting for any building, for any region, and also we'll also study some of the study how we can do the case studies in terms of with respect to climatology in detail. Okay. So firstly I would like to give a brief about outline about this particular presentation. So we'll start with first with definition and Earth-Sun relationship, the relationship because of which there is so much of we can say in detail about what are the effects of sun on earth and how it is getting affected in terms of climate. We'll also study the elements of climate, measurement of these climatic elements, how we can break down different elements of climate, and then we can study and how we can measure and how we are going to store the data for a particular climate. And also we are going to study the factors, other factors which are going to affect the climate. So starting with the definition, the word climate comes from the Greek word klima, which is defined as region with certain conditions of temperature, dryness, wind, light, etc., or you can say various other factors. So we can also say that climate is a physical condition of a particular physical condition of a particular place at a particular time. Okay. So it is also an integration of time of physical states of the atmospheric environment, characteristics of a certain geographical location. Now each location on earth has different climate and this climate is been changing from time to time. Okay, if you take let's say if you're taking 1,000 years before, so there was a different climate. So that is why when we study climate for any particular region, we study it for let's say 10 years. Okay, so if you are studying climate for let's say Bangalore or Belgavi or Gulbarga or Mysore, so we are studying the climatic data for 10 years so that we get to know what is the characteristics of that particular climate. If we are studying a climate which is more than 30 years, then we may not be getting suitable data that is required for your building design. That is because we also know there is a gradual change in climate because of various other factors. Let's say it is global warming, yes, it's because of pollution, because of the melting of polar ice or something that is happening, or maybe because of some micro conditions that particular site. So there is always some kind of change in the climate for every, you can say, after every 10 years. So we take out the average of for the past 10 years, and then we take that particular data for a particular climate and then we try to use. Now this climate is nothing but the atmospheric condition around us. in terms of various factors. Those factors we'll study in detail today. The difference between weather and climate, we can say weather is a same condition of the atmosphere, but for a very shorter period. So weather, sometimes it can be changing for every day. Even in summer, sometimes because of let's say rain, a weather might be different for one particular day. Okay, in one particular day also there might be sudden changes in weather. There might be weather changes because of, let's say, wind, because of sky conditions. Let's say we are getting some cover, cloud cover. So because of that, there might be sudden rainfall because of maybe conventional rains or some other rains. So there might be some sudden changes in the weather. But whereas for a climate, we try to consider it for a longer duration. That is, let's say we assume it for 10 years. Okay, we usually try to study for 10 to 30 years for a particular geographical location. Okay, so that is how we can get what are the different elements of climate. Okay. Now, Earth and Sun. Earth is the only planet in the solar system which is having habitable space. That habitable space, the atmosphere, is because of many reasons. So one of the reasons is because of the sun distance of the sun to Earth. Okay, the sun, Earth revolves around the sun in an elliptical orbit. This orbit is not exactly the sun is not exactly in the center of this elliptical orbit, but it is slightly off center. So the closest to the sun can be, you can say, 147 million kilometers, and the highest distance that is, you can say, 152 million kilometers. Okay, so Earth revolves around the sun in this particular elliptical orbit, and it is also, we can see that it is tilted. The Earth's orbit is slightly tilted, that you can say it is exactly 23.5 degrees to north. Okay. Now this is the reason why there is this elliptical orbit, that is the plane of the elliptic, as you can see in the figure. So this elliptic is the orbit which is revolving, and this is the tilt. So this is the actual axis around which the Earth rotates around its own axis, and also it rotates around the sun. Okay. Now this tilt, you can see, it is 23.5 degrees. Okay. So this tilt also is the reason why there is a different climatic zones, or you can say there are different kinds of climate that are created on the surface of Earth or in the atmosphere of Earth. Okay. And this is also a reason why there is heating variations. So Earth is basically, let's say, circular in shape. So you can see the sun angle. So that is the sun that is hitting the Earth surface is at various angles in various places. Because of one, it is Earth is a round ball, and it is also tilted towards the north axis. So it is getting heated up. So you can say the Earth is getting heated up more where the sun rays are vertical, or it is, you can say, sun rays are perpendicular to the Earth surface. There the Earth's surface get heated up more. Where it is at an inclined angle, as the inclination increases, or it is more inclined, so then a lot of sunlight is getting reflected. Now this sunlight, we know it carries lot of energy in terms of heat. So we know sunlight is a packet of UV rays. Yes, it is in terms of, it contains lot of energy, packets of energy. So when the sunlight hits the Earth surface perpendicular, lot of heat is absorbed by the Earth surface. If it is at certain angle, then lot of heat is getting reflected, and only some amount of area absorbs the heat from the sun. Okay, so that is why there is overheating in some places. There is polar regions are getting or not getting heated up, whereas we can see the central tropical belt is getting more heat. That is because sun rays are perpendicular more towards the in the tropical region. Okay, so this you can see the axis of rotation. So basically, based on the longest day and or the location of the Earth and also this tilt, so we can categorize into two categories mainly, that is summer solstice and winter solstice. Okay, summer solstice is basically in June 21st or 22nd for the northern hemisphere. We can see this is the equator. So equator, we can see that the sunlight is falling perpendicular to the Tropic of Cancer, whereas it is getting at a certain angle to the Tropic of Capricorn. So more sunlight is hitting this particular northern hemisphere, or you can say towards the north of equator, there is the sunlight is very much perpendicular, so this portion gets heated up. Okay, so this portion is getting heated up more, so that is why this can be considered as summer solstice in tropical countries. Okay. Now if you consider the Earth and the land mass on the Earth, so more of the land mass is towards the north. Okay, so that is why we majority of people who are living in Earth are also in this particular land mass, which is, you can say, majority of the land mass consider June 21st or 22nd as summer solstice. On the summer solstice, what happens, this is a longest day and you can say it is shortest night. The sunrise happens pretty early and pretty late sunset, and we can see that the next, that is December 21st or 22nd, is considered to be winter solstice. During this time, what you can see, the sunlight is hitting the southern hemisphere, the southern south of equator, perpendicularly, but whereas to the north of the equator it is at certain angle. So because of this angle, what happens, the Earth sun rays gets, yes, when it falls on a particular let's say, yes, so when it falls on a particular this thing surface, it gets reflected because of the angle, because of the incident angle. So here it is getting reflected, so there will be more, you can say there will be more reflection, or there will be more reflection, that is because of the Earth surface, and then there will be more heating up in this area because the Earth surface is perpendicular. Okay, so the heating or cooling of the Earth surface happens because of this incident, solar incident. Okay, it is not because of the sun's position, which is closer or away from the sun, or away from the sun. Okay, the main heating up and cooling on the Earth surface happens because of this. Okay, if you consider that, then Earth is usually closer to the Earth. Earth is usually closer to the Sun during January, whereas it is away during let's say June. Okay, even though northern hemisphere experiences summer solstice, it is away from the Sun during June. Okay, so that is why there is various heating up and cooling that is happening in the atmosphere of Earth. Okay, and in between, we can say, so in between there is yes, equinox, where there is equal day and equal night, where sun hits the Earth axis is actually parallel to this incident sunlight, and then there is equal day and equal night. Okay, and in this time also, the equatorial region, that is the tropical climate, the tropical region experiences more sunlight, but because comparatively these area will get more perpendicular sunlight, whereas these other areas will not get more, that is a lot of sunlight is incident at a particular angle and it gets reflected. Okay, and here lot of heat is absorbed, lot of sunlight is absorbed, so that is why this position, during this position, what happens, so there is equal day and there is equal night. Okay, so this you can see all the four seasons, that is summer solstice, yes, winter solstice, and both the equinox. So there is a vernal equinox that happens in March 21st or 22nd, and there is autumnal equinox that happens in September 22nd or 23rd. Okay, so then we can see the sun is usually at the at equinox, the sun is at the equator, perpendicular to the equator, but whereas for summer solstice, the sun is perpendicular to the Tropic of Cancer, and for the winter solstice, you can see the sun is perpendicular to the Tropic of Capricorn. Okay, so because of this, what happens, because of this, the rotation and also the incident of sunlight, there is various heating of surface of Earth happens at various times. Okay. So equator, which is, or this region which is considered as equatorial, or it is also considered as tropical climate, tropical region. So this experiences lot of sunlight that is perpendicular during the stage change during different seasons, and lot of heat is produced in this region. Okay, lot of heat is absorbed by the atmosphere also. And since we know that hot air rises up, as the atmosphere, as the surface gets heated up, even the air is getting heated up, and that hot air rises up. So we can see in this section that towards the left, the hot air, that is the red arrow, so it is hot air which is rising up. Okay, and it gets cooled and it again get condensed and it is forming this particular cell. Okay, so this is called as Hadley cell. And there is also, so this is nothing but we can say the air movement in the atmosphere that happens. So along the tropic, so there is usually the rise in the hot air, and there is this thing, it gets cooled. As it gets cooled, so again it gets, it tries to come to the surface. So this similar process happens in the polar region also. Okay. And there is some kind of movement of air because of the Earth's rotation around its own axis. So because it rotates around its own axis, so there is again trade winds that are formed along with the surface of Earth. Okay. And this is forming from the east-west, and there are easterlies and also there are westerlies. Okay, because of the rotation and the cell. Okay. So this is how we can say that the air is trying to maintain equilibrium. So we always know that as per law of thermodynamics, the heat always tries to attain equilibrium. Okay, so that is when we say, like, wherever it gets heated up, it tries to cool down, and wherever it is getting heated up, it becomes low pressure area, and wherever it is colder or which is having more humidity, so there it is high pressure areas, and it will always try to attain equilibrium. Okay, so that is when there are lot of wind movement or air movement that is happening on the surface of Earth, or you can say in the atmosphere. Now this air movement also causes, there can be yearly monsoon winds, or there can be some other temporary winds, or there are also cyclones and these things that are created because of these air movements. Okay, because of the when there is air from two directions are coming at a particular in a particular geographical location, it tries to form a whirlpool or twister. So that is when there is cyclones that are created. Okay, now it is not just the air, but we can classify the elements of climate as temperature, humidity, wind, precipitation, solar radiation, sky condition, vegetation, and other special characteristics. We can study any particular climate of a particular geographical location in based on these different elements. Okay, so these different elements will help us to understand what is a particular climate, and these, all these elements are studied for let's say a duration of 10 years. Okay, so starting with temperatures, temperature is the temperature of the air, that is ambient temperature, that is measured with the help of a thermometer which is having a mercury thermometer. So there can be a dry bulb temperature or it can be a wet bulb temperature. Okay, so dry bulb temperature will give us the ambient temperature, that is whatever the current temperature of air is, and this temperature is measured with the help of Stevenson screen. You can see in this image, so there is this box with a lot of wooden lures. So this box is kept at a certain particular height, and it is usually covered because other elements should not affect the measurement of the temperature. Now there are various bulbs that are kept in this Stevenson screen, so which shows there is a wet bulb, there is a dry bulb, and other thermometers to actually check what is the temperature of that particular place. Okay, and this is usually covered because it should not be affected because of let's say rainfall should not affect the measurement of the temperature. Okay, so this temperature is again recorded in maximum and minimum temperatures. So it is that data is collected for average of 30 days, that is maximum temperature. When we say maximum temperature, it is for the highest temperature recorded in a particular day. Okay. Let's assume that if you want to record today's temperature, it can be recorded for especially for tropical climates, you can consider for the temperature that is recorded at 3 p.m. Okay, so that we get the highest temperature or the maximum temperature. And similarly, minimum temperature is recorded during the night, where it reaches whatever it reaches the minimum temperature or least temperature. Okay, so that is considered as minimum. So if you take the average, that is mean of one particular month, so then you can record what is a maximum temperature of 30 days that is recorded at highest, that is nothing but the highest temperature of particular days, and minimum temperature is nothing but the minimum or least temperature for consecutive 30 consecutive days. Okay, so then we can calculate what is a monthly mean, that is average of each day's maximum and minimum, and the average for it in it for 30 days. Okay, so that then we can say the mean maximum temperature for, let's say, during summer or for the month of January, mean maximum would be the average what is taken for that particular month of let's say January or June. So we record the highest temperature that is recorded in day and the minimum, that is least temperature, that is recorded at night for all the 30 days, and then we take the average. So then we get these data, that is nothing but mean maximum and mean minimum temperature. Okay, so this data is collected for every month. So then we can know what is a summer months or winter months or what are the different climatic changes in that particular, especially the temperature changes for different months. So monthly extreme, that is might be for that particular month, what is the highest ever temperature recorded for that particular month. Usually it is during the afternoon, you can say around 2 to 3 p.m. So that is when we get highest temperature that can be recorded for that particular day. Okay. And similarly, extreme minimum, that is the lowest temperature that can be recorded. So these usually we try to consider the extremes so that we can design buildings based on the extreme temperatures. So that is the maxima and the minima. So based on the highest recorded temperature and the minimum recorded temperature, we try to design buildings. Okay, so how we are going to design buildings, that we will going to study in the next modules. So humidity is also one of the very important factor that causes, that is helpful in let's say thermal comfort. Okay, we also know that humidity is also responsible for various other factors, that is bacteria growths, or you can say fungus growths, or various microorganisms. It is also responsible for various other activities also. Sometimes you can say machines also consider a certain amount of humidity that is to be present in air for the functioning of those machines. So humidity is nothing but again water vapor that is present in the air, or you can say water vapor that is present in atmosphere. So that is usually measured in terms of percentage. When we measure in terms of percentage, it is relative humidity. So relative humidity can be basically studied in three aspects. You can say absolute humidity, relative humidity, and also saturation point. Okay. So absolute humidity is nothing but the amount of moisture actually present in air for a unit mass or unit volume of air. So if we can consider for 1 kg of air mass, then what is the amount of moisture in that particular 1 kg at particular temperature. Now humidity, when is recorded, it varies, it or it changes based on the temperature. So when we are recording humidity, it has to be said that it is trying to see in what particular temperature. So because it behaves differently, if there is increase in temperature, then there is more humidity. If there is a reduction in temperature or less temperature, then the humidity also reduces. So it is also dependent on temperature. It is not very independent, but we need to understand the humidity so that we can also effectively utilize the temperature, that is by having various passive strategies. Okay, so absolute humidity is nothing but amount of moisture actually present in that particular volume or weight of air. If you are taking 1 kg of air, so what is the actual humidity, that is water content in that particular 1 kg of air? It can be in terms of volume also. When we are taking 1 kg, 1 meter cube of air, so what is the humidity present in that 1 meter cube of air? So that is again in measured in terms of gram, that is weight of water per particular volume. Now saturation point humidity is nothing but it is the amount of moisture that water can hold. So if we say that a particular mass of air or volume of air is completely saturation, attained its saturation, if we are saying that it is achieving 100% humidity, it means it is completely occupied with water vapor. Okay, so it is completely occupied with water. So the when a particular air is not able to hold further moisture, so then also we can consider that as saturation point. That is, it is holding maximum amount of water in particular volume of air or in weight of air. So then it is considered as saturation point or humidity, where it is 100% humidity, where it is holding the maximum amount of water that it can hold a particular air. Okay. Now relative humidity is studying the relationship between, as the name itself indicates, it is very relative. Okay. The ratio of actual amount of moisture that is present in air to the moisture that it can hold. So that is nothing but expressed in terms of percentage. So okay, how much of water it is actually holding and how much of water it can actually hold. Usually when we say 30% of humidity, it means that the volume of air has around approximately 30% or actually 30% of air, 30% of water. So that is why it is very relative. Okay, so and relative humidity is usually used for better understanding of climatic data, so that we can usually in all the psychrometric charts and other charts what we see, we usually consider relative humidity for the working or designing different elements, or you can say designing different elements. Okay, so we try to study in terms of relative humidity. And even if we see a lot of any weather data, so then it is given in terms of percentage, so that is nothing but expressing the relative humidity in terms of percentage. Okay. Now this similar to the temperature, humidity data is also monthly mean maximum, that is what is the maximum humidity for 30 days and minimum for least for 30 days that is measured, and so that is how it is measured. Now one more element of climate, that is one of the major element, you can say it is wind. Wind is nothing but the movement of air. Okay. Now the movement of air can be in the horizontal movement in any direction, or it can be vertical movement of air. Okay. Now if it gets a surface, as we see that because of the earth surface getting exposed to sunlight, so it is getting heated up. When it gets heated up, there is the hot air which is rising. Okay. And sometimes it also takes moisture along with the air, so we can say that it considers water vapors. So there is air movement that is happening vertical, and there is also air movement because of the earth's rotation, or the air movement also happens because of the high pressure and low pressure areas created. When there is some surface of earth which is getting heated up, and the hot air rises up, so it is also creating a low pressure area. Okay, so the temperature is more and it is creating a low pressure area. And other regions, let's say somewhere polar region or other region, so where there is lot of moisture and less temperature, so there it might be it can account for high pressure areas. So these high pressure area, the wind or the air moves from high pressure area towards the low pressure area, so this causing the wind movement or air movement. Okay, so there are vertical winds or vertical air movement or horizontal air movement in the atmosphere of earth. Okay, so this data is very important because when we study thermal comfort, as we can see, if the temperature is more or temperatures, so we need to harvest this particular wind to see how we can make a natural ventilation within the buildings. So to provide that, we need to know from where the wind is coming and for which direction, what is the direction of the flow of wind, and also what is the speed of the wind, so that if it is very so depending on the speed of the wind also our comfort level changes. Yes, so the air in atmosphere always moving. When it moves vertically, it could cause the cloud, or it also causes rain. When it moves horizontally, it is called as wind. Okay. Now this wind velocity is measured by cup type or propeller anemometer, and the direction of wind is found out using a wind vane. Okay. It is represented by using a Windrose diagram, which represents which explains both the direction of the wind and also the intensity of wind. So when we try to study the wind, so it is in terms of velocity, that is the speed of the wind, and also the direction of wind, in which particular direction it is. Okay. Now this wind velocity is also again taken for different months. Okay. So for different months we try to consider, and so this is again nothing but a Beaufort scale, so where it is explaining the wind speed and also type of description of wind. So we can see calm wind, so that is 0 to 2 kilometers per hour is considered as calm wind, that is very pleasant, or you can say. So light air movement, so 3 to 5 kilometers per hour, so, and light breeze, so 6 to 11 kilometers per hour. So up to this we can say it is very it is very comforting, but whereas when it increases, then you can say gentle breeze, moderate breeze. So as it increases, we can see the comfort level also decreases, and these are the various possible effects of the wind movement at different wind speeds. Okay. So if it is more than 120 kilometers per hour, then it is considered as hurricane. Okay. If it is 102 to 120 kilometers per hour, then it is considered as violent storm. Now this wind speed is also measured in terms of meters per second or kilometer per hour. Okay. Usually if it is for indoor air calculations, indoor air movement, then it is considered as meter per second. Okay. Precipitation. Precipitation is a collective term that is used for the collection of water. Okay. So now water that is the moisture that is present in atmosphere is precipitated, or it gets condensed in various other forms. It is not just in form of rain, but various other forms. We can see it in the form of dew that is formed in the morning because of condensation of water on the, let's say, on the leaf, on the grass, or on any sometimes on vehicles. So there is dew that is formed, and mist that is again in the form of water vapor, but it is comparatively cooler. Fog is also where there is moisture content in air. Rain, where you can see water that is from the clouds, it is when it is raining, so there is again this is also considered as precipitation. Hailstones, so that is again in the form of small ice, these things. And also snowfall, that is very colder region experiences snowfall. So these are the various different forms in which water gets deposited or collected in the atmosphere on the surface of Earth. So that is considered as precipitation. It is collectively called as precipitation. Okay. Now this precipitation is measured by using a rain gauge. So it is a conical flask, what you can see, this which is having readings. So the water that is condensed gets collected here, and then we can measure in terms of mm. Okay. Now this rainfall is again measured for different months, for monsoon, for various other months, and also what is the annual rainfall for that particular region. Okay. Now this precipitation is also very important, that will be used for classification. Okay. Classification of various other climates based on the precipitation that happens in particular geographical location. Okay. Now solar radiation is also very important. The solar radiation is one of the major factors that causes different climates and also different weather changes. Okay, if it is very for a short period, it is weather changes. If it is for a longer period, then it is climate. Okay. Now, Earth receives almost all of its energy, that is in the form of light, light energy, from the solar radiation. So, because of the Earth that is very round, so there is different intensity of solar radiation that will be in the different surfaces. Okay, because some places experiences less radiation, because some amount of light is getting either diffracted, reflected, by let's say different layers of atmosphere. Okay, there is stratosphere, ionosphere, different layers of atmosphere, and there are various particles that are in the different layers and various gases. So because of which there is, and also water vapor and other gases, so because of which there is some kind of changes in the solar radiation. It is not very constant, so it keeps changing based on the sky conditions or condition of the atmosphere, you can say. Okay, so if there is lot of sandstorms or dust storms, so then if there is lot of dust, then the radiation is reduced. If there are a lot of clouds, then the radiation is reduced because there is a lot of blockage. Okay, and this radiation is also changing because of the angle of incidence of the sunlight on the surface of Earth. Okay, so that is why this solar radiation is also an important factor for the harvesting of energy into the you can say food chain. So there are various plants, the vegetation is also very much influenced by this solar radiation. Okay. So the intensity of radiation reaching for the upper surface of the atmosphere is considered as a constant, that is 135 watt per meter square, but it actually may vary plus or minus 5% due to variations in the output of sunlight itself, because of the sun it is having various changes in its own atmosphere. So then it is also considered that 3.5% of changes is due to the distance of the sunlight, and some amount is radiation is also because of the cloud formation or let's say dust or the content of the atmosphere, whatever it might be, the water vapor or different gases which keeps changing. Okay, so if there is more radiation than that area, obviously there is going to be increase in temperature, which will also affect other elements of climate. Like there will be wind movement, there will be more wind movement because of low pressure areas, yes, and there will be a reduced let's say humidity. So there is again changes that are been happening because of this atmosphere. Here you can see there is some amount of this thing, radiation is reflected or deflected by atmosphere, yes, and because of clouds or because of some other factors. Okay, so only some amount of radiation is directly hitting the surface of Earth. Okay, now this is in the form of shortwave radiations or UV radiations. The heat that is reflected back can be considered as long wave radiation. Okay. So this is measured by the solar radiation is measured by sunshine recorder. So this device is basically considered of a glass ball that focuses sun rays onto a special card that is bent. So based on the the rays of the sun, because of it is getting concentrated at a particular point on the card, so it burns the card. So because of based on this, we can calculate what is the radiation of the sunlight. Okay. So sky conditions is actually usually described as the terms of presence of absence of clouds. Okay. So usually the sky conditions is measured in terms of percentage or the proportion of the sky that is exposed, or you can say the surface of Earth is exposed to the sky or it is covered with the sky. Okay. So this is studied again based on the climatic conditions for that particular month. Okay, or particular, it is not studied usually particular for different days, but for on a monthly basis. Okay, for what this thing. So that the sky condition also influences the solar radiation. Okay. The vegetation can influence local climate or site or microclimate. Now, vegetation is another element that again influences, let's say, microclimate or a climate of particular smaller site, and also maybe for a larger extent. Okay. Now, vegetation is also getting influenced by various other climatic factors. You can say climatic elements. That is, it can be sunlight, it can be solar radiation, it can be sky condition, it can be temperature, humidity, wind. So these various elements of climate will influence vegetation, and vegetation in turn will influence the climatic factors. Okay. So there is also we can say that there is small climatic changes that happens at a microclimate is because of the vegetation. Okay. So important element in design of outdoor spaces and shade protection from glare. It is also very much influenced for the wind movement. If there is a lot of movement, then vegetation can be used to control wind movement. Vegetation can also influence various factors like soil erosion, yes, wind movement, and also it is used to try to control the sunlight. If it is more sunlight, we can grow more vegetation and things. So, but it becomes very important to study even vegetation so that we can see how we can use this vegetation to particularly cut sunlight or to protect from the harsh wind, if there is any particular harsh wind or wind movement, and how we can protect the land mass from getting the soil getting eroded away. Okay. So vegetation also becomes one of the major important factor of different element. Now this vegetation is documented for different geographical locations based on that particular climatic zones. Okay. So vegetation changes for different climatic zones, and also it is influencing different climatic zones. The special characteristics, most regions experience these conditions which are unfavorable, like hailstorms, thunderstorms, squalls, earthquakes, tornadoes, dust storms. So based on these special characteristics also we can design the buildings. Okay. So these are also considered for designing of particular buildings. Okay. So there might be a lot of hurricanes in particular area, there might be earthquakes which are frequent in a particular zone. We know that India is divided into different earthquake zones, where it is from the highest frequency of earthquakes to lowest frequency of earthquakes. So based on that, we can consider what can be the adaptations or changes or elements or technology that can be used for different areas. So these are some of, maybe so considered as some of the special characteristics for particular area. For a particular geographical or for a particular geographical location. So these special characteristics has also been studied in detail as a part of climatic data. Okay. So along with that, there are various other factors. You can say latitude, that is location of earth, land and water, the distance from the land and distance from the water, or the different distance from the land and water. So that is again increasing the humidity, or it can be also influencing in terms of wind movement or wind direction. So that also influences the climate, or you can say it also influences the microclimate. Okay, low and high pressure cells, as we can say that the tropical or equatorial belt is usually low pressure area where there is lot of heated up. So that is also you can say a factor which is affecting climate. Okay, in terms of landforms, you can say the mountains or barriers or reliefs, so that is causing again maybe barrier for a wind movement, for monsoon winds. So that again leeward side or windward side, so that we study in terms of microclimatic factors. So even those mountains or barriers or reliefs they also acts as a one of the factors for affecting a particular climate. Okay, so there might be sudden climatic change in particular climatic region. Now let's consider if there is a very hot region and if there are a lot of mountains, because of altitude, so there is again the change in the atmosphere, okay, or the change in the climate. That is because of, let's say, altitude and mountains, and even there is changes in vegetation because of this geographical let's say composition. If the soil has let's say more organic content, then there will be a lot of vegetation. If there is less, then that is also one of the other factors that are affecting the local climate. Okay, so these climate of any particular area can be studied in these different elements, and they are all integrated, they are all interdependent, and along with the surroundings, that is environment, along with vegetation, flora, fauna, and all other things. We all know that nature itself is engineered itself considering all these climatic elements. Okay, if you take any animal or any bird or any insect or any plant, they have already considered all these elements of climate, and they have engineered themselves, and they are also building whether it might be nest or beehive or these things, considering all these climatic elements. Okay, so we also try to study in detail about these factors, different elements in detail, and try to study and try to understand how we can design buildings based on this particular elements. Okay, so an activity that can be suggested was to collect site climatic data for different climatic for different geographical locations, because we get different climatic data for let's say it can be for a in a tropical climate, or it can be for some other country, it can be for India, it can be for various other continents. So then we can study how these different elements are in different proportions, where there might be higher temperature, less temperature. If you consider certain places where there is average change in during monsoon or during summer or during winter, so we can see that how there is different variations of different climates or of different regions. Okay, so based on that, you can also see the buildings, you can also study the buildings, how they have adapted themselves for these particular extreme these particular climatic changes. So there might be climate which is having extreme temperatures, which is having extreme rainfall, precipitation, or there might be climates with extreme wind movement. Okay, so there you can study how people or how animals, how birds, how plants have evolved themselves for that particular climate. Okay, so this helps us to design buildings in those different particular climates. Okay, so that is the end of this presentation. So thank you.